praise the Lord. Isn't the Lord good? Let's give him a praise. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. You're so good, Father. We love you. We thank you. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you that our hearts will be so stirred and challenged this morning. You never leave us as we are. We always leave changed when you are involved in our lives. And Father, we're rising above this world. We're rising above all these circumstances that are negative and not from you. And we thank you, Lord, you have given us authority in this earth in Jesus' name, and that our circumstances are subject to change. So Lord, we thank you for this day. Work in our hearts, renew our minds, and let our lives glorify you in everything we do and in everything we say. Amen. Let's give the Lord a praise. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, you're welcome. You can sit down. Just greet someone quickly. I don't know. You probably did. Just say good morning, good looking to somebody. If it's your wife, give her a kiss now. If it's your wife, give her a kiss. If it's your wife. That's it. That's what I like. I remember you guys last time, yeah? The Lord is good. It was really awesome to be with you back at the Faith Pleases God Church. You know, I see so much going on. I don't know about, I was here 2 years ago, and I just feel God is moving. Get ready, get ready, get ready. Amen? Because when God moves, we have to be ready to run with what God wants to do. Amen? I mean, when God comes to down, you comes to town, you don't sit down and go to sleep. Hello? You know, we move with God. Amen? Anyway, I'm so grateful to Pastor Kevin and Veronica for inviting me to come share with you. And he's been such a blessing to Africa. Just to tell you, he has been such a blessing to Africa. He comes, he sows his life, he sows his time. He doesn't expect anything in return, and he's been such a blessing. And, you know, when he goes, God imparts in him, and then he comes back and he imparts in you. And we can't all go on the mission field, but if he can go and for a couple of weeks and you giving him that time, you will receive a reward from the Lord for allowing him to go. But the greater thing is that God will do a work inside of him that God cannot do when he's at home. We grow when we are out there. Every time I go overseas, I grow in leaps and bounds, because when you're at home, it's like you can't see the forest for the trees. When you come away from your home and you're away from your home, God can really speak. So pray for him always, that God will cause him to rise up stronger than ever. Amen. And be who God's calling him to be, because then you will receive a blessing when that happens. Amen. So it's lovely to be with you. Thank you for having me here. I know we're going to have a really good time the next couple of days. I shared this morning in the Spanish service that, you know, God gives the fivefold ministry gift to the body of Christ. And in Ephesians it says, for the perfecting of the saints. If you only hear one of those gifts, you are not perfected. You've got to hear from the prophet, the pastor, the evangelist, and the teacher, amen, and the apostle. You've got to hear from all of them to be fully rounded. It's like if you just live on salad, you're going to have a problem. You'll be nice and skinny, but you won't be very healthy. You need some protein, you need some bread, you need a bit of everything, amen? Healthy, balanced food, and that's what you get from the fivefold ministry gift. And so I am evangelistic, but I'm really a teacher. I love to teach the Word of God, amen? And I get to preach a little bit here and there, but I'm mostly a teacher. I like to do line upon line, precept upon precept, and for me, it has to work. I just don't like pretty words. I like that word must change your life. That you must come away from here not saying, oh, that was a nice message. You must say, oh, my life has changed. Amen. Because we need to be growing, and God wants to do a work in us. And if our hearts are open, listen, I've been 37 years in the ministry full time. I'm telling you, I learn something new every day. You're never going to outlearn the Word of God. You're never going to outlearn God, because he is so full. I mean, good measure, pressed down, shaking together, and running over. He is abundant. Amen. And so the more we hunger, the more we thirst, the more we give God access to our lives. You know, he doesn't force himself on you. You've got to Want him in your life. You can come and sit here and go, you know, and be bored, but you're not going to get anything if you come like that. Come hungry. Come excited. Say, Lord, speak to me today. Give me wisdom for this week. Give me understanding for this week that my life can change and become what you want it to be. Because God is always going to cause you to grow. He's always going to feed you. God is rich. He's rich in life, in peace, in goodness. Take what he has for you, amen. Just be grateful that he shares it with us. Hallelujah. So it's awesome to be with you this morning, and we're going to have a good time today, tonight, Tuesday night, Wednesday night. Tuesday night, I'm going to be signing books for anyone who wants to get one of my devotional. I just brought this out in January. I can't believe I talk so much. 400 pages of talking. What is it with women? We like to talk. Couldn't believe 400. Well, it's a daily devotional, so it's 366 days, but there's some other talking in there as well. But this book will really help you on a daily basis. I mean, before you read anything, read the Word. Amen. Then if you have some time, read this, okay? It will encourage you, inspire you. It's just one page for each day, has a nice scripture and a little teaching, and it'll set you into your day with a good attitude. Amen. You know, no, good Lord, it's morning, but good morning, Lord. Amen. Amen. And it's available. I think we only have 8 now. I've ordered some more. They've just put an order in from Amazon. Hopefully we get them by Wednesday. So if you want a copy, listen, if you're going to buy someone a Christmas present, please don't buy them something from Walmart. I mean, you can, but rather buy them something that will touch their life. Amen. And then here, I have this is a 5-CD pack. There are 5 CDs in here of really good teaching. It's called For Women Only, but the men always listen to it. There is a CD in here called Women of Excellence that I taught how to be a woman of excellence. And there's a CD in here I taught a group of men on how to be men of excellence. And I taught the women what a man needs. And I taught the men what a woman needs. I think we should do that now. Don't you think that would be good? But then there's a CD in here of Dr. Mike Murdoch on the uncommon woman. Very, very powerful. And another message, am I hot or what? You know, the Bible says we need to be hot. Hello? Hot. Am I hot or what? I hope you're not lukewarm. So I'm going to give this to this gorgeous woman that I just love so much. It's a gift from me. I love you. She's awesome. She's just growing in leaps and bounds. She's awesome. You watch her. Watch her. Watch what God's going to do. You are very blessed, church. You have two pastors. You have pastors that love God. And all they want to do is serve him. That's a gift God's given you. You need to value that gift. You need to appreciate that gift. Amen. Take her for lunch, spoil her a little bit, buy her some chocolates, amen. Pray for your pastors, love them because they're going to be feeding you what God has. Now, you're going to get it from God yourself, but they are also going to be imparting. If you don't pray for them, then don't expect much. But when you pray for them, God will really use them and bless you, amen. And I want to give these over here to my interpreter this morning. I love you so much. I forget your name now. Mary Beth, thank you. She said she wanted them now, so she got them. Hallelujah. All right, so are you ready for the word? We're going to have a good time. Look, I've got to tell you this because I'm a sharp tool. I'm very sharp. I mean, I can say things, they're very sharp, amen? Hello? But because I'm sweet, you can handle it, right? I had a pastor say to me in Arizona, he said, oh, Pastor Linda, you're a very sharp arrow. But because you're sweet, we can handle it. So I said, well, thank you. That was the positive side. But you know what? There's no time to mess with pretty words. You know, look at the days we're living in. They're cutting people's heads off. We haven't got time for pretty words. We have to let's be truthful. Let's press in. Let's get the gold that God has for us. Let's be challenged. Let's be encouraged. And let's be fine-tuned. Amen. And to grow up as Christians and no longer be baby Christians. I don't want to be a baby Christian. Baby Christians can't do anything for themselves. You know, a baby Christian is like having a natural baby. A natural baby can't feed itself, can't change its diaper, so it's got lots of problems. I don't want to be a baby Christian. I want to grow up and become mature in God. Amen? So it's time to come off the pacifier. No crying. I want my pacifier. We're going to take the pacifier away. And we're going to change the diaper. Say amen. Because we're all going to grow in God. Amen. So the word is sharp. It's always sharp. But my delivery is usually quite firm and solid. So forgive me now before I offend you. Will you forgive me now? I have your forgiveness. So now can I go for it? Okay. Hallelujah. Gentlemen, please look at me with, I know I'm blonde, but hallelujah. Well, all right. God uses a donkey, he'll use anybody, right? He'll even use you and me. All right, let's start. My message is titled, My Now Purpose. My Now Purpose. I called it that because we are always in movement. We're on a journey. You know, your life is a journey. You look back at your life. Some of you, if we could hear your stories today, we'd probably be crying. We'd probably laugh. We'd probably have compassion on you. We'd probably celebrate with you because all of our lives have a story. And some are more wild than others. Hallelujah. Some stories we don't want to hear, you know. But we all have a story because life is about a journey. And we're on this journey. And while we're on this journey, there are all kinds of processes we go through. It is a process. It's about growing, maturing, you know. I mean, you start out, you've got to make it through, you know, elementary school. That's the purpose. Go finish elementary school. Then you graduate elementary school. Now it's middle school. You have to pass middle school. And now it becomes high school. So the purposes change as we mature and get older. And some of you are believing God for a husband. Now that's your purpose. I want a husband. Amen. But when you get one, you think, I wonder if I should have prayed. No, I'm only teasing. I'm only teasing. But you know, it's process. And it's, you know, the in process, there is always preparation. We don't like preparation. I didn't like school, but I needed school. Because how am I going to get to where I have to be if I don't learn to read and write in this day and age? Say amen. So as much as, you know, we don't like the preparation is what takes us to where we're going. And we don't want preparation, but you need preparation. So wherever God is taking you, there'll be many different, there are many different parts of your journey. Some of them you'll complete as a young person, and then that season is over. Now you're moving to the next season. And with the next season comes responsibility, comes preparation. Amen. You don't just get married, you know, and not prepare for a marriage. I mean, if you want to get married, you better learn to cook. If you're male or female, hallelujah. But there's stuff about marriage you need to know how to do when you do it. You can't just get married and stay, live a life of a single person. You're no longer single. So preparation for the journey and for the different processes that you go through in life on your journey. And life is not a destination. Life is filled with different destinations. And ultimately, you'll be like me, you'll be a granny. I never thought I'd be a granny. I have two grandbabies, one is 3 and one is 5, and boy, oh boy, they're two boys, and they are busy. And I thought, oh, you know, I just can chill now, I'm getting older, no chance. I mean, my little 5-year-old the other day says to me, Granny, can we swim? I said, yeah, because we're in summer now. I said, yeah, we can swim. Granny will fix the pool. He says, Granny, have you got your swimming? Have you got your bathing suit here? I said, no, Jono, that's the problem. He says to me, you could wear mommy's bikini. I said, I will not be wearing mommy's bikini. You know, when you get to my age, that's something you don't look at. So we want full cover, you know. Anyway. I'm happy. I hope you're happy. Process, journey, destinations, and what God is doing. but it's all for a purpose. Your whole life there is purpose. And the most important thing is, Paul said, my determined purpose is that I might know him. My whole purpose, Paul said, my whole purpose in everything that I'm doing and everything that I've done is that I might know him. And the sad thing about it is very few Christians can actually say that. That I know him. Oh, you might know Kenneth Copeland and you might know Joel Osteen and you might know Pastor Kevin, and but do you know him? Do we know him? Because when we know him, we are then on the right track to growing up and becoming mature in God. When we're not looking to others all the time to help us with our need, but we look to him and our eyes are on him. You see, Isaiah 55 and verse 9 says this, and this scripture has been speaking volumes to me. The last 2 years, I start every sermon with the scripture because I honestly believe that if we don't get the scripture as Christians, we're going to really struggle. And the scripture says, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my thoughts higher than your thoughts, and my ways are higher than your ways. And right there, God is telling you, don't think like the world thinks. You have to come up higher and begin to think like I think and to begin to do life the way that I'm instructing you to do life. Only when we start to think like God thinks can we get a bigger vision. Can we receive what God has for us? If I spend my life thinking God wants me sick, I will never get my healing. I have to think, what does God think about sickness? And I have to put sickness in its perspective of what God thinks about it. Then I rise up above what's holding me in bondage and I begin to overcome it by thinking like God thinks. He says, my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. So if we're going to continue to think like the world thinks, we're going to stay in bondage to the world and the world's way of doing things. And then I'm limited. And then I'm bound because the world is a mess. The world is confused. There is no hope in this world. But in God is everything that I need. Everything I need is in God, and everything I need comes from God. So I need to be a vessel open to change, open to growth, open to maturing, because I'm a child of God. I'm not a child of the world. The Word of God tells me I'm an ambassador to this world. I represent the kingdom of heaven. I'm in the world, but I am not of the world. Hallelujah. So we mustn't act like the world just because we're in the world. We're supposed to act like a child of God because we come from the kingdom of God. We are spirit beings having a natural experience. You are not a natural person, a human being having a spiritual experience. You are a spiritual being having a natural experience. You are a spirit. You have a soul and you live in a natural body. You are not a body with a spirit. You are a spirit with a body. Your body will die and go back to dust, but your spirit will soar and live forever. So you are a spirit being. So why do we back our whole lives on the world? The world has nothing to offer us. We are not subject to the world. Yes, we obey the laws of the land, of course. But as far as our victory and our joy and our peace, it doesn't come from the world. You look at people that have so much money, most of them don't know, they're the most miserable people in the whole world because they don't know the source of the provision. And when you think the source is yourself, you're going to be very disappointed because you know you fail you all the time. You let yourself down. So God's ways are higher. We have to come up higher. We've got to stop doing it like this. come up high and do life the way God says. And I mean in everything. Do marriage the way God says. Not do marriage according to so-and-so's opinion. Because you might have an opinion and I respect you for your opinion, but your opinion doesn't matter to me if it's contrary to the Word of God. The Word of God is the only opinion I'm prepared to live by. And I will still respect you and honor you, amen. But I'm not going to compromise what gives me life for a second opinion. Amen. I don't care if it's politics, especially if it's politics. My goodness me, have we lost our mind? That it's okay to do what we do with babies and things. Seriously? Oh my goodness. So we have to change that. If we think like the world, that thinking has to change. And God will work on you morning, noon, and night until you hear what He is saying to you. Because He is for you, not against you. He wants you to win. He wants you to be successful. And so He's constantly in your ear. But if you're not listening, He can't get through. So you will carry on with the same old, same old, same old, same old until you are prepared to listen to God, the author and the finisher of life. If anybody knows how to do life, it's God. Woo! Woo! He knows how to do it. He's already overcome and defeated the devil. So He's not there going, oh, but what's the devil going to do? He's in His face saying, get thee behind me, Satan. There's a better way to do life. There's the right way to do marriage. Got to do it God's way. Whatever area you refuse to do is the area that's going to destroy your marriage. You've got to be willing to do it like God says. I'm talking from experience. And I haven't had 10 marriages. I've had one. And I wish I knew then what I know now. It's so sad. Sometimes we only learn by bad decisions. It's the hardest way to learn, but please let us just learn by mistakes. Don't do the same old again, again, again. One married, two, three, four, five. When are you going to stop? Because maybe something is wrong that you need a change in your heart, in your life, in your thinking to be able to have a fruitful marriage. Hallelujah. It's the same with money. I mean, if you had to work out how much money has gone through your hands over a period of time, we need wisdom how to handle the little bit we do get. When we use that wisdom, perhaps we could use it more wisely and deal with money the way God says we deal with money. He knows about money. He owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. His streets are paved with gold. He has a great giant pearl that is the entrance into heaven. He has no lack. Hallelujah. He has no lack. We need to do it His way. When He says, this is how you manage your money. Listen. How hard is it just to listen to God? God, thank you. You know how to do this. I'm going to do it your way because your way works. Your way is higher. Your way is better. Hallelujah. When God spoke the word, let there be light. When He spoke it into the emptiness and into the void that was over the earth, the moment He spoke those words were active and energizing, and light was. And light still is today. It was spoken, I don't know how long ago, but it still holds right now up where it's supposed to be. And it will hold until God changes it. No man will stop it. Only God can stop it. Because it's His word. And He watches over His word to perform it. So whatever it is I'm going to do with my life, raising children, I've got to do it God's way. It's the only way that works. You as my sister and my brother, if I don't treat you the way God says I need to treat you, I'm going to have issues and difficulty in my own life. It's not going to affect you, it's going to affect me. Because how I treat you is how others are going to treat me. So I have to listen to God on how to treat you as a child of God. I have to listen to God how to treat you if you are my enemy. So whether you love me or you don't love me, God has a way that I should treat you because he wants me to have the best outcome and he wants me to be victorious. Now, if I want to do it my way, eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, I will land up with no teeth and no eyes. Because that is the world's way of doing it, and that's under the old covenant. It's not new covenant. It has nothing to do with Jesus. Jesus came and God said, from now on, this is how you deal with your neighbor, with your enemies who hate you. You see, nothing should change who we are. You know, as you grow in God and you begin to mature and become a nice, beautiful Christian, say amen. Say that's me. Say that's me. That's me. Say that's me. Amen. When you go somewhere and someone doesn't like you, and when someone who really doesn't like you, they've lied about you, they've said things about you, just say, for example, you're in a room and that person who is your arch enemy walks in. Do you become somebody you are not just because they walked in the room? Then who are you really? Are you really a Christian or are you really this fleshly person that wants to fight? See, nobody should change us because we are like Jesus. So we are not like Jesus just with nice people. We are like Jesus even with the ones who hate us. Because that's who we are. We are children of God, not children of the world. So when we come on a lower level, the way the world does things, we get worldly results. And it's always strife and confusion and rubbish. Say rubbish. See, that's what it is. But when we choose to do things God's way, to rise above, in the process, in the preparation, towards your purpose, there's always going to be growing needed and necessary. There's going to be things that you thought were so important now that in 3 years' time, you will have let them go and you think, why did I make such an issue of that stuff? It's really not important. And you'll begin to take on the things that are important and that matter to God, hallelujah, and get rid of all your little childish, fetish little issues. Oh, see, now I must stop. Okay. So while we're in this thing of growing, Paul said that I might know him. And the more that we come to know him, and I'm serious, church. I'm serious. I've been through some things in life, you know. I've had life. I've had wonderful things. I stood on a stage with President Nelson Mandela, and I was asked to pray for him publicly. He said he wouldn't come unless he could hold my hand. I mean, seriously, Nelson Mandela. He said, I'm not coming unless I can hold Pastor Lindy's hand. And he did that. He took my hand. He held my hand the whole way through the service. And then they asked me to pray for him publicly. I'm probably the only Pentecostal, Holy Ghost, Spirit-filled woman, blonde, who ever prayed for Nelson Mandela publicly in front of 12,000 people. You know what? A highlight of my life. But I've had very low lights too. I've had hard times. I've had hard days. But the hard days seem like nothing when God is with you. Because you always, life happens. Stuff happens. You can't blame God because the tire went flat on the car. I mean, come on, let's grow up. Amen. Let's say, well, the tire's flat. I praise you, Lord. Let's get it fixed. Hallelujah. And not stay in the flat tire. Get over it. Let's move forward. Let's go on. Let's grow. Amen. And then, you know, in the hard times, You know, that's when the best work is done in your life. When it's hot, then you find out what is inside of you. Because when things are good, it's wonderful to be a Christian when it's good. We all can be Christians when it's good. Amen? Oh, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. But one little issue comes and you don't want to go to church anymore. I'm not going there anymore. The usher was rude to me and I'm tired of this. No, you actually need that because you have a bad attitude. So let's work on your attitude. Hallelujah. And maybe when your attitude changes, maybe you will have a better life. Amen. And I've had God work on my attitude. The things that the Lord has led me to do. Sometimes I think it's things I've led myself to do because I've said, Lindy, you're going to have nothing of you and all of God. And I think I've put myself through some things that have been God never required it, but I required it of myself. Because I thought I would rather do this really well and know that there is gold inside of me than leave a little bit just, you know, God, you don't mind. I'll just keep this little bad attitude over here because, you know, you can't see it. I know it's there, but let's just ignore it for a moment. I want God to get in my life with a bright torch and shine that light on me. Wherever there is a little bit of issue, expose it to me, Lord, because I don't want anything to rob me of anything that you have for me. And it's called growing up. And it's called victory. And it's called freedom. Ha! Freedom. Hallelujah. When nothing has a hold on you but him. Paul said, I might know him because when he has you, you have got such liberty, it's unbelievable. And nothing affects you. They can break in and steal everything in your house and you'll go, oh, well, God will provide. Oh, well, hallelujah. God obviously has a better bedroom suite for me. I receive it, Lord. Thank you. I'm glad they stole it, Lord, because I didn't really like it that much. Hallelujah. When you start getting to that place, where you and your wife have fought over the same nonsense for years, he doesn't like you to hang the towel up over here, but because you're making a point, you're going to hang it there every day just to irritate him, just to show him that you still have your rights. So you fight every day. It's rubbish. It's stupid. It's wasted energy. It's, give me a word, ridiculous. Instead of just saying, you know, darling, I'm sorry. I'm not going to do that anymore because I want you to have a good day. So, and then he'll say, well, you know, honey, if you do that for me, this is what I'm going to do for you. You know, you like me to put the dishes in the washing machine and I just don't do it. You know what? I start to do that. Instead of you working on pleasing each other, let's work on pleasing each other. Let's outdo each other in pleasing each other. Hello? Honey, would you like a foot rub now? Can I rub your feet now? You see, I would make such a good wife now. But anyway, Paul said, this is my determined purpose. Then Jesus said, what was Jesus' purpose? Jesus didn't come here just for nothing. Just to hang around the earth for a while and to love us and to bring us to salvation. The word of God tells me that this was the purpose of Jesus, the purpose to destroy the works of the devil. So what are you fighting the devil for? It's done. It's over. You're wasting your energy. Jesus already destroyed the works of the devil. All you have to do is enforce it. If you're fighting devils, I feel sorry for you because you're wasting your energy. They're already defeated. All you have to do is walk in the light of what you know and your authority in the name of Jesus. And if the devil pops up, you say, get behind me. Get out my way. You don't have to speak to him. You don't have to find out his name. No conversation necessary. Get thee behind me. End of conversation. Let's move on. Hallelujah. You see, there's a peace and a rest. There's a victory when you're in God, when you know who you are in Christ. And you don't have to come every week and try and, you know, get someone to pray for you, get someone just to touch you, or God, just touch me. No, yes, God will touch you, but he says, live in my embrace. He doesn't just touch you and leave. He loves you 24/7. He's with you 24/7. You know, there's something I've been thinking about too, how we say, God, I want more of you. If you're born again, you have him. Does he come in pieces? Or does he come? You see, we measure him by how we receive him. You've got to say, Lord, I want all of you. All of you. I'm not holding anything back. I want everything. I want you in my morning, my afternoon, my night, my marriage, my home, my finances. I want all of you. I'm not holding anything separate from you because I want you in my whole life. You can't have him in pieces. But some people only want to receive him as they want to receive. So it's okay, Lord, I'll forgive those people, but don't talk to me about my money. Don't talk to me about my money. But I'll forgive, but my money will talk next time. See, God wants to be in your whole life. And who wouldn't want him? I mean, there's none like God. Nothing can stand against him. Nothing can stand against him. Hallelujah. Nothing can measure up to him. In fact, when he had to measure himself, he had to measure himself by himself because there was no one good enough to approve of him. He's the only one who can approve of himself because he's the only one who qualifies. Woo! Wow. Your purpose. Esther said her purpose was for such a time as that. For such a time as this, but it was then. She was come for such a time as this. What is your purpose? Where are you now? What are you doing with your life? Where are you going? What are the things that you feel God's wanting you to do? Well, in this whole thing, there's going to be preparation. But there's a couple of things that we have to keep in our lives while we are in this process of life. There's some things that need to stay stable in our lives. You cannot be up on Monday and down on Tuesday. This lifestyle has to change. I love God. Sunday morning, things don't go right, so now I don't like God. And then next week, maybe I'll love him a little bit, and then maybe I'm just, you know, fed up, had enough. We've got our line with God must be like this. Stable, solid. It doesn't matter if tornadoes come and hurricanes come or thieves break in and steal. My relationship with God remains like this. Hallelujah. Nothing moves me from God. Nothing shakes me from God. He's my foundation. He's my strength. He's my peace. He's my joy. He's my healing. He's everything. Hallelujah. And whether every pastor in America sinned, it's not going to move me because my eyes are not on them. My eyes are on Jesus. Hallelujah. You see, when we keep looking at men to make our relationship with God right, you'll be disappointed because your family will let you down. The government will let you down. Obama will let you down. The police force will let you down because none of them are perfect. The only one who's perfect is him. So you've got to have your eyes on him. So there's a few things that are going to help you. And I want to share just a few of those points with you, and I think we'll carry on tonight. The first one I want to share with you, as you're going in this process and on this journey of life, growing, maturing, doing things God's way, the one few things that are going to keep you stable and solid, number one, stay in his presence. Stay in his presence. And I'm talking about 24/7. I'm not just talking about in his presence on Sunday morning when there's worship going on. I'm talking about Monday morning when you don't feel like going to work and you're fed up and you've had nothing good going on for a while. Stay in his presence. Get your peace from him. If they've told you you're fired, you don't have work anymore, you've got kids crying, a wife who needs food for the children, stay in his presence. Because in his presence, there's fullness of joy. In his presence, there's provision. Amen. God will never leave you in lack because he is your provider. It is up to him to provide for you. When you have lost your way of provision, God has to be your provider. And you can test him on it. Now, if you're just lazy and you don't want to get a job because you're lazy, hello, you will get lazy results. You won't eat. Amen. Am I being nice to you today? Amen. I've lived this, so I'm only speaking to you from what I've had to deal with myself. When God talks to me, I talk to you. Amen. Stay in his presence. You see, the word of God tells us in John 15, it says, I am the vine and you are the branches. God says, I am the vine. I am the supplier of the sap that you need to produce the fruit in your life. He says, I am the one who will give you the sap. You're not going to get it anywhere else. You've got to get it from the vine. He is the vine. I am a branch. I'm a branch. The word says if I am united in him, united means one. When I'm one with him, everything I need will come up from the vine and flow through me, and I'll start producing fruit. Not some fruit, much fruit. Have you ever seen an apple tree? Have you ever seen a branch of an apple tree going, oh, I wish I could just produce an apple. It's natural for an apple tree to bear apples. The only time there's a problem is when the soil is bad, which you'll never have with the vine of God. Or the vine is sick. Now, the vine doesn't get sick. Amen. Not on our case. Because we are adopted into the Beloved. He's engrafted us into his vine. His vine is perfect. He is perfect. But he welcomed us and engrafted us into the vine. And here we are. We can just be blessed beyond measure. I don't have to force it. I don't have to make it. It's a natural flow. The sap comes from him and I produce fruit. And the sap comes from him and I produce fruit. It says, cut off from me, you can do nothing. So how many of us try to make our marriage work without God? When you don't get the sap that helps the marriage to work, it's hard work. It's tiring. It's exhausting. It's frustrating. But when I come back into the vine and I let him do it in me and through me, it's easy. I will produce the fruit. But I have to be listening. I have to be willing for the sap to work through me. Notice the fruit doesn't grow on the vine. The fruit does not grow on the vine. So he needs me. For his fruit to be seen, he needs me. And for me to bear fruit, I need him. Hallelujah. How awesome. It's relationship. God wants relationship. He wants us in him. Hallelujah. I'll just read it to you. John 15, it says, verse 4, dwell in me. Dwell. That means you don't visit. It's like the secret place. He who dwells in the secret place, not he who visits the secret place. You've got to dwell there. It's got to be your home. It's got to be where you run to. When things are good and when things are bad, that's where you run into his presence. Woo. Dwell in me. And God says, dwell in me and I will dwell in you. Live in me and I will live in you. Just as no branch can bear fruit of itself without abiding in or being vitally united to me, to the vine, neither can you bear fruit unless you abide in me. I am the vine and you are the branches. Whoever lives in me and I in him bears much abundant fruit. Two scriptures there, two verses, one after another. He will make you bear fruit. However, apart from me, you're cut off and you can do nothing. I like this verse 8. It says, when you bear much fruit, my Father is honored. Don't tell me God doesn't want to bless you. Right here, it says here in verse 8, When you bear, produce much fruit. My Father is honored. Because he knows you can't do it on your own. So the more fruit you produce, the more you are in him and he is in you. And you will turn around and say, I did nothing. God did it all. Abraham said, let no man say that God made me rich. No, let no man say that he made me rich. Only God made me rich. Only God can make you rich. Only God can bring that fruit in your life that speaks volumes. It says even the Jews will be jealous. Come on, church. Come on, church. I'm not talking about money. That's one little part of it. I'm talking about peace and joy and healthiness and wholeness. I better hurry here. Okay. So that's the one in the vine where the sap comes from, where you can bear much fruit. It's not hard to bear fruit. It's natural. Say it's natural. Natural. Say I'm a child of God. I will naturally produce fruit. Some of you have only produced 10%. And I think I'm challenging you today. There's more fruit for you to begin to bear. The more you yield to him, the more fruit you will bear. Amen. Amen. And bearing fruit is a joyful thing to do. You don't look at a healthy apple and go, I don't know. You go, oh, I want to taste that. Oh, can I have a little bite? Amen. Everybody gets to enjoy it. The second thing is to stay in the word. First one, stay in his presence. Second one, stay in the word. Ooh. You see, we love the Spirit of God. I mean, I've grown up with the Holy Spirit. I've grown up in the Spirit. I mean, I've had meetings where I would baptize women. They'd come down the stairs. They fall out under the power, under the water, and I've got to go pull them up because I think they're going to drown. And I'm talking in the middle of winter when the water's like ice cold, not heated pool. They go out under the power. I have to pull them up. They come up, healed, speaking in tongues. I love the Holy Spirit. I've had meetings where we've been so drunk. Hallelujah, you don't want to leave the meeting. You just want to stay there because you don't want to leave the presence. Sounds like the sheep on the front row here. Stay in the word. Listen, without the Spirit, the word without the Spirit, you dry up. That's when people become legalistic. It's all by the law. Well, you better do it this way. And the word of God has got to be mixed with the Spirit, because otherwise it becomes the letter. And the letter kills, the Spirit gives life. The word of God is alive, but it's not a law anymore. Under the Old Testament, it was the law. Now it's Christ. It's Jesus, the word of God. It's grace. Say amen. Amen. All right? You have a choice to do it or not. It's, you know. But listen to me. The Spirit, the word without the Spirit, you dry up. That's why we have dry Christians everywhere, because all they do is they read the word of God, but there's no Spirit. No Holy Ghost. All Spirit and no word, you blow up. Because now you're so freaky, Spirit, there's no word in you. So you're looking for spirits everywhere and you get weird. You get weird. You get flaky. God told me this, that he is my husband. Oh, really? But he's married. Hello, church. We have got to have the word, because the word is the most solid foundation. You've got to have the word and the Spirit. If you have both, you grow up. Yeah, grow up. So the word is something we always have to stick on. I always say, I'm sorry, where does it show you that in the word? In fact, a lot of the moves of the Spirit of God with different moves, there's something I can absolutely welcome. People get drunk in the Holy Ghost. People run, because you remember the Ethiopian ran with the chariot, right? Wasn't it the Ethiopian that ran with the chariot? He ran faster than the chariot got there before. I mean, I've seen people run in the Holy Ghost. It's awesome. Running around the building. I see that. I'm happy. I see people get drunk in the Holy Ghost. I'm happy. Hello? But when people start writhing on the floor like a snake, Reinhard Bonnke said to me, Pastor Lindy, those people we put in the pit to get deliverance. He says, I don't understand this stuff. Because in Africa, that's how a snake is. And snakes go in the pit. Be nice if you go to a Holy Ghost meeting and you act like a snake and they throw you in for deliverance. People, we've got to stay with the word. Because if we don't, the devil's going to use anything to take us off track. And we've got to stay with the word. If it's in the word, that's good. Let's do this. Amen? Stay with the word. So you have to grow up in the word. The word has to be your foundation. The word has to be everything that you need. The word is everything you need. Hebrews 4 verse 2 says, for the word that God speaks is alive and full of power. That's why it's still holding in place today. Whatever God said, when he said it, it's still holding in power right now. And it won't change unless God changes it. And making it active, operative, energizing, and effective. And it is sharper than any two-edged sword. You see, the word of God goes deeper than a surgeon's knife. A surgeon's knife goes deep, believe me. But it cannot pierce the spirit and the soul. So even the natural is an image of what the supernatural is. But God's word pierces the mind from the soul. That's why sometimes you have to separate your feelings and your emotions because they don't line up with what is right in the spirit. So you have to go with the spirit, amen, and with the word. Say amen, somebody. So that word is so powerful. So whatever we do, we have to stay in his presence. We have to stay in the word. Because the word will always give you the right answer. And look for two or three confirmations. You can say, I need that confirmation of that. Amen. Rather be sure than rush ahead with something and make a huge mess of something. Amen. I've always said to God, God, I need that by two or three witnesses. And God will always, he always confirms it. He has no problem doing that. Amen. But go with the word, because Matthew 4 verse 4 says, man shall live by bread alone, but man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Matthew 24:35 says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word will stand forever. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will stand forever. You see, you can take God at his word. If he said it, believe it, that settles it. If God says the higher thought, forgive those who've hurt you, then just do it. Don't question it. Just do it and go free. Go free. Say amen. And then John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 2, the same was in the beginning with God. Verse 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelled among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten Son of the Father, full of grace and full of truth. So we have to stay. We need those foundations right in our lives. If we're going to be solid Christians, that whatever comes our way, we remain stable. We don't get bent out of shape. We don't throw our toys out the cot and behave like we're 5 years old. Say amen. We grow up and become mature in God. Then no matter what comes our way, we are rooted, grounded in God's word and in him. And nothing moves us. Nothing moves us. Only the things that are confirmed will move us. Amen? And then you'll see the devil start having a hard time. Because if he can't move you, what's he going to do? You see, he wants to distract us all the time so that we don't stay on the things that are important. And listen, there's a lot of things we need to do right now, church. We got to be on the ball. Amen? There's a world to be saved right outside these doors. Hollinger needs to come to Jesus. The city needs to come to Jesus. There's a contention for the city. The devil wants it. He's not going to have it. Amen. Are you listening? He's not going to have it. And if the church, if we do our part as the church, we can change this whole region. Amen. it's not just us. We must, all the churches must be involved. Hallelujah. Because God uses all of us, however much we will let him use us. So I pray I've encouraged your heart today. Maybe a little painful here and there, but that's also good. Amen. When God gets on me, I get on you. Nothing I'm sharing with you, I haven't had to go through myself and come out strong on the other side. Because God wants you better and stronger and wiser and happier. God wants you to have a happy life. Happy, say happy.
Happy.
Some of you need a tablespoon of happiness this morning. How about a smile on your face? That's a good place to start. Amen. But I love you, church. It's an honor for me to be here today. Thank Pastor Kevin and Veronica for inviting me and trusting me with this pulpit. I know that this pulpit has been through much. But let me tell you, get ready because there's great things coming. Great things are stirring in the spirit. Amen. And so would you mind just bowing your heads, please, and let's give those an opportunity this morning that perhaps they've never come to know Jesus. That's where we start. The way you start a brand new life. I just was always so amazed when I first got born again that God would give me a second chance at life. And he does give you a third and a fourth, and he really does. But the fact that he would give me a second chance at life was always so amazing to me. That he said, I've got a brand new life for you, but you have to choose it. See, God is so amazing that he doesn't force us with anything. He says, choose it. Choose this day whom you will serve. Amen. Choose light or darkness. Amen. You choose it. And so today, I want to give you an opportunity to choose. And there are some people, I'm sure, that have never received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And you'd like to say, Pastor Lindy, today, I want to give my life to the Lord. I want to be born again. I want my life to change. You can't change your life on your own. You've tried and tried. You cannot change it. Only God can bring you to that place. Amen. Only he can help you to change. Praise God. Amen. So if that's you this morning and you say, Pastor Lindy, please pray for me. Today, I want to give my life to Jesus. If that's you, please, would you just raise your hand quickly? I'm going to pray for you this morning. Say, Pastor Lindy, please pray for me. God bless you, sir. Just lift up your hand. Pastor Lindy, please pray for me. God bless you. God bless you, sir. Madam, at the back, God bless you. God bless you there in the middle. Sir, bless you. You see, you can't do it on your own. You need him. You need him. I gave my life to Jesus when I was 19 years old. It is still the best day of my life. And you know what? Even though I've been through challenges and been through, God is more real to me now than he's ever been. And he's more wonderful than he's ever been. Maybe it's because I'm falling in love with him more and more and more. Because he's so good. Amen. Praise the Lord. Anyone else? I see that young lady's hand over there as well. That's sir at the back. Praise the Lord. Just give him the opportunity. Give him the opportunity. One last call. Anyone else? Praise the Lord. All right. God bless you, ma'am. I see your hand there as well. All right. You know, when we do an altar call, sometimes in some churches, they just pray with you where you are. In other churches, they invite you up to pray for you. You know, Jesus said, if you will confess me before man, I will confess you before the Father who is in heaven. I just feel it's so good to make that commitment. I mean business with this. I mean, this is my, I mean business. And so I'm going to invite you to come up this morning. So if you have raised your hand this morning, please would you stand up and just come down here and I'm going to pray for you this morning. Let's welcome them. There's quite a few folk. Come on down. I'm going to pray for you. Come down. There's quite a few hands. Praise the Lord. Amen. Come down. Hallelujah. There were quite a few on this side, ma'am. Won't you come down? Didn't you raise your hand? Come. You see, you want change, but you're not prepared to make a step towards change. Make a step towards it. Come. Make that stand. Hallelujah. God will meet you right there. He will meet with you right there. Hallelujah. Because he's so faithful. Hallelujah. You know, his ways are just higher than our ways. You know, we keep trying to bring God down on our level. He's not going to do it this way. We got to come up to his level. Amen. Praise the Lord. Is there anyone else that needs to be here? Just ask the person next to you, say, do you want to go down? I'll go with you and you can bring them. Just ask the person next to you if they've received the Lord. I usually do this. And if they say no, then say, would you like to? And then just bring them down. This will be the best day of their lives. They'll never forget this day for as long as they live. Is there anyone else? Praise the Lord. Anyone else? Is this young man, does he want to come down? He can come. I saw some hands go up at the back there. I was just wondering if you had come down. Come down. Okay. Praise the Lord. Welcome. I'm so glad you're here today. Is this your sister? Your niece? How long have you been praying for her? How long have you been praying for her? How long? 5 months for her to come to the Lord. And here she is today. You know why she's here? She's here because you invited her. I think she loves you a lot. Does she love you a lot? Boy, she's a good aunt. That is a good aunt. Sir, thank you for being here this morning. And you, sir, thank you for being here, ma'am. Hallelujah. Did someone tell you about how did you come here this morning? You came with him? Is this your husband? Did he used to come here without you, or did you just come to visit this? You brought him. You have a good wife. Do you have a good wife? She's awesome. How long have you been married? 2 years? It's going to get better. This today will be the beginning of amazing things for you. It's not going to be easy, but God's going to help you with it all. And you're going to smile. In 10 years' time, you'll say, that was the best day, a better day than when you got married. Because today you're becoming one spiritually, which is amazing. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So I just want to welcome you all. Welcome, ma'am. Nice to see you. Welcome, ma'am. How did you get here today? How did you get here today? Do you come here? Quite often you're just making a recommitment. You know, maybe you're in the congregation and you just feel you want to recommit your life today. I mean, I don't encourage people to recommit their lives, because once you give your life to Jesus, you've given your life to Jesus. You don't have to do it every week. Now you can just say, Lord, I receive you, but really, he saves you, you're saved. He doesn't do half a job, he does a whole job. But you see, he's always there. We drift from him, he's always there. And sometimes we need to turn around and say, you know, Lord, I've drifted from you. I need to come back where I'm supposed to be. Are there any people here this morning you'd like me to pray for you? You feel you need to get right back where you're supposed to be. Any hands can see? Anybody want me to pray for you? Hallelujah. If you want me to, I will pray for you. But let's pray with these folk to receive the Lord this morning. You need to write this day down somewhere. Never forget this. This is the day you receive Jesus into your life personally. It's not a religious thing. It's a relationship that you are entering into today. Amen. So say this after me. Say, Heavenly Father, I come to you today and I thank you for reaching out to me and loving me since the day I got born. But today I choose to receive Jesus as my Lord and my Savior. Jesus, come into my life. Wash me and cleanse me in your blood. Help me to live my life to please you. Help me to be the best me that I can be. Jesus, thank you for saving me. Thank you for dying for me. And right now, I will never be the same. In Jesus' name, I'm born again, a child of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. I'm gonna let you stay up here. I'm gonna give a call for the Holy Spirit right now, because you know, receiving Jesus is your first step. That's a first step. But there are some other aspects to your growing, and you might just want to jump in the water today. You know, sometimes we put our toe in, you know, and then we wait a week, and then we put our foot in, and we have a slow process. Other times you just want to jump in. Amen. And we should want to jump in because God is so amazing. It's the best way to live your life. And Jesus said that we all need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, what happened to me is I was so afraid of the Holy Spirit because of the way that people behaved. Not because of what God said about the Holy Spirit, but because I saw people doing crazy things in the name of the Holy Spirit. So I ran away for 2 years. I ran away. Whenever they said anyone want to receive the Holy Spirit, I'd run away and hide. And I was terrified. I had people hit me on the head. I had people throw me on the floor. And eventually I thought, these people are mad. Really, Lord, I love you and I want the Holy Spirit, but this is not on. And eventually I said, Lord, I'm not looking at them anymore. I'm looking at you and I want to receive everything that you have for me. And if you want me to have it, it's for my good. God only wants good things for you. Why? Because God is good. God doesn't have good. God is good. He was good before. He's good now. He'll be good for eternity. His nature is good. It's the devil that's evil. There's no evil in God. So when he says, when, you know, it's like if you work for a company and you say, your boss says to you, you've begun this job, you know, and your boss says to you, I'd like you to go down to the store and buy me coffee in the mornings. And you go, I don't think I'll do that. I think I'll just do this part of the job. But that part, you see, God won't tell you you need something if you don't need to do it. It's part of the process. So why wait 10 years for the second stage? You need it all now. Get it now. Why wait? The Holy Spirit is a gift. You don't have to work for Him. You can't buy Him. You can't pay for Him. He's free. And Jesus said to the disciples, you go in the upper room and wait till you receive power from on high. I believe He spoke that to something like 300 to 500 people, because that's how many were saved more or less at that time. He said, go, Jesus instructing them, go and wait upstairs till you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. How many went? 120. I don't want to be in the bunch that doesn't listen. I want to be in the bunch that says, I'm here, Lord. Pour it on, Lord. I'm here. So if you're one of those people that's never went, or you went and got offended, or you went and you got afraid because people did stupid things, don't base your relationship with the Holy Spirit on people. Base it on your intimacy with God. He'll never do anything to you that embarrasses you, or because the Spirit of God is sweet. He's the gentle, sweet Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Never get you to do anything that would not glorify God. Amen. So if that's you this morning, you say, Pastor Lindy, I've never received the heavenly language. That's me. I need that today. Would you lift your hand up quickly if that's you? If you're not filled, God bless you. If you're not filled with the Holy Ghost, get it now. No more wait. No more delay. God bless you, sir. Anyone else? Put up your hand. I know there's a few folk. Don't hesitate when it comes to God. Are you going to listen to Jesus or no? Amen. Anyone else? Okay, come down, come down. Those of you who raised your hand, come down. I'm going to pray for you right now. Hallelujah. Come down. Those of you, I know there's more of you. And I'd just like to say this, church. I mean, I can beg you to come. I can beg you to come, but why put me through that? Pull teeth. God's pulling teeth again, begging you to come and receive from Him. Just come. Out of obedience, just come and let God fill you. Hallelujah. Next time everyone prays in tongues, you're right there with them. You're not standing there going, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, Jesus, I love you, Jesus, I thank you. They're all praying in tongues and you going, thank you, Jesus, because you're not filled. Come and get filled. Amen. Hallelujah. So we're going to pray for you this morning. You're going to receive a gift. I don't know if you've ever heard about praying in the Spirit, have you? You haven't? Well, let the Holy Ghost do what He's going to do. Just don't be afraid. Just receive the Holy Spirit today. You might as well get it all. Amen? All right. So Jesus told them to go in the room and wait, and they received power from on high. So we're going to now go into that place. Amen? We're going to ask Jesus to baptize you with the Holy Spirit. It says when the Holy Spirit came on them, it says they began to speak. They did the speaking. The Holy Spirit doesn't force you to speak, and He doesn't speak through you. It's your spirit that's communicating with the Holy Spirit. Why do we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit? Number one, we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Why? Because it says when we speak in other tongues, we speak to God. And the best part, it says when we speak to God, nobody understands what we're saying. It says they speak to God, no man understands them. That means the devil too. So I'm glad I can speak to God and the devil doesn't know what I'm saying. Amen. And sometimes I don't know what I'm saying, but my spirit knows what I'm saying, and that's all that matters, is that my spirit is speaking to God. Amen. The second thing is it says that we edify ourselves, we build ourselves up. Now, I don't know about you, sometimes I do wake up on a Monday morning and I'm tired and I just feel loaded and burdened. And I can open my eyes and I just say, Lord, I give you this day. And I begin to pray in the spirit. And in 2 minutes, 2 seconds, the load lifts. Hallelujah. The load lifts. And you feel that empowering of the Spirit. And the Holy Spirit says, I'm here for you. I'll help you. I'll quicken you, whatever you need. Amen. Very easy. Does anyone else need to be down here? Anyone else? Please, folk, come and receive. I know there's more. I know there's more because the Lord's told me there's more of you. Come, come quickly. Can I see your hands? Anyone else? Praise the Lord. Okay, we'll just go with this. Thank you, Lord. Are you filled with the Holy Spirit? You are, so you're okay. All right, I'm going to pray, and you just by faith begin to make sounds. And the Holy Spirit's going to fill you, okay? Give you a heavenly language. How long have you been a Christian? Long? All your life? No. Okay, but so your intimate relationship with the Lord began today. Well, that's amazing. That's so cool. And you say, that's right. And you also the same. Now, how long have you been a Christian? Since 15, and you've never been filled with the Holy Spirit. Do you know why? Have any idea? Just afraid? Never heard about it? Never seen it? Given an opportunity? Oh, wow. Okay, today's your day. All right, let's pray. Say this after me. Say, Heavenly Father, I come to you today in the name of Jesus. And today I choose to be filled with the Holy Spirit, that He will fill me to overflowing. Jesus, you are the baptizer. Baptize me in the Holy Spirit now, in Jesus' name. Now I want you just by faith to begin to make sounds, and He's going to fill you. Robata, but you go ahead and pray. Give a new language, Lord. Just by faith, begin to make sounds. Are you filled with the Holy Ghost? No. So by faith now, begin to make sounds. He's going to fill you. That's what you're here for. You came here for that. Quiero mandolo ba sombre bebe beuro, my fellow Jesus, to overflow and get a ma sombre bebe. By faith, begin to make sounds. Kole maka, begin to make sounds. Begin to make sounds. Open your mouth. Rebe da bra ba kane be sombre. That's it. Let that go. Let that go. Rebe ke sombre. Bring no more romoshma. Church, would you pray with me, please? Everybody that's filled the Holy Ghost, pray with me. Koro mande lebe shoma. Let that go. Are those words you don't understand? Don't speak Spanish and don't speak English, okay? By faith, can I hear you? Begin to make sounds. Let that go. I'm coming back to you. Fellow Lord, overfeed, flowing. Now, don't beg. I want you to, by faith, make sounds, and you're going to get filled like that, okay? Let's go. That's it. Let that go. Close your eyes. Fellow Lord, she's got the Holy Spirit. She's filled. Let that go. Can you feel that power? That power? You feel it? That's the Holy Ghost. That's the Holy Ghost. Pray, pray, don't stop. Thank you, Lord. Just by faith, begin to make sounds. He'll fill you. Fill him, Lord. He's filled. He's filled. He's filled. That's the Holy Ghost. Let that go. It just sounds. You won't understand them. It's not to do with your mind. It's to do with your spirit. It says your mind is unfruitful. Fill him, Lord. That's the Holy Ghost. That's the Holy Ghost. Begin to make sounds. That's the Holy Ghost. Let that go. That's the Holy Ghost. Let that go, sir. let it go. Get him out. They both filled. Hallelujah. The more you pray, the more that's coming. Let that go. By faith. By faith. Begin to make sounds. He's going to fill you. Now, he doesn't make you speak. He's not going to come and take your mouth and do this. You got to give him something to work with, okay? Lord, overflowing. I know you just gave your heart to Jesus, but you know what? God wants to fill you. He's going to fill you. Oh, that's a touch of God all over you. Lord, he's beginning to make sounds. Have you ever felt that before? Have you felt the touch of God before? He let him fill you. See, I want you to get filled with the Holy Ghost. That's important, okay? It's part of your walk with God. That's it. You got it. You got it. Thank you, Father. Fill him, Lord. Just yield to the Spirit of God and he'll fill you. I know it's crazy. It seems crazy. But sometimes God has to take us out of our natural minds because he's not natural. He's spirit. Amen? That's it. Just here, get him a corner. Touch him, Lord. How to fill him to overflowing. Get him a sombre. You are responding. Just keep going. Don't stop. Hallelujah. Father, I bless this man. Thank you for healing him, Lord, today. Thank you for healing anything that's broken, anything that's sprained. Heal him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet in the name of Jesus. Now, Lord, fill him with your spirit. Oh, Rabbi. Just begin to make sounds. He's going to fill you. Do you want the Holy Spirit? By faith, make sounds. Begin to make sounds. Come help me. Help me. That's the Holy Ghost. That's the Holy Ghost. Awesome. That's the Holy Ghost. Touch her, Lord. Thank you, Father. She's filled. She gets saved today and filled with the Holy Ghost all on the same day. That's how God does things. Why wait 5 years? Why wait 5 years? Amen. Isn't that awesome? I'll give you a hug. You're awesome. Now listen to me. The devil's going to come and tell you it. This is nonsense because he comes immediately to steal the word that's sown because this empowers you. And if he can disempower you, he wants you to be a weak Christian. Jesus said this empowers you. I believe Jesus. Jesus said it, not me. Okay, the devil wants to disempower you. So he's going to say, this is all nonsense. You don't need it. You're making the words up. Whatever he says, leave it. Just ignore him and you just follow God. Take what God has because God has a reason. You too, I want to bless you quickly. Hold hands. Father, I bless this couple. I bless their marriage, Father. I pray that they will grow stronger together. And whatever it is they desire, Father, that you will meet that need in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Amen. And how are you doing? You get filled? Get filled? Okay, well, you want it. Then you go home and just be okay. You don't need it public. Okay, I got on my own. That's how I received. Praise the Lord. How awesome. Amen. Praise God. So awesome. That was quick. Aren't you? How do you feel? How did it feel when you got filled? Isn't it just, but it's natural, isn't it? I mean, just comes because the Word of God says your spirit. You are a spirit. Your spirit is speaking to God. So your mind doesn't understand. You go read a Corinthians and you'll see where Paul said, I pray in the spirit and I pray with my understanding. He says, I sing with the spirit and I sing with my understanding means what you understand. But he said, when he sings in the spirit, he knows he speaks the word of God and the will of God for his life. So your intellect is nullified at that point because God's dealing with your spirit. Amen. Go read Corinthians. It's full of them. Okay? Amen. Let's give the Lord a praise.